Take your Bibles and turn with me tonight in the New Testament to the book of James, James chapter 3. And we are almost through this third chapter. We'll spend tonight and then, Lord willing, next Wednesday night, and we'll finish chapter 3. This evening, I want to talk to you about James chapter 3, verses 9 through 12, as we look at blessings and blastings, fountains and fig trees tonight. Follow along with me, James chapter 3, starting in verse number 9. The Word of God says, "Therewith bless we God, even the Father, and therewith curse we men, which are made after the similitude of God. Out of the same mouth proceedeth blessing and cursing. My brethren, these things ought not so to be. Doth a fountain send forth at the same place sweet water and bitter? Can the fig tree, my brethren, bear olive berries, either a vine, figs? So can no fountain both yield salt water and fresh." May the Lord continue to add His blessings to the reading of His Word. After having talked to us about the tongue being like a fire, the tongue being like an unruly beast, the tongue being like deadly poison, James delivers his closing argument, as it would be, on the tongue by citing two illustrations. While one comes from our experiences, the other comes from nature. Taken together, they demonstrate the problems with the tongue again. And so the first item that I want you to see tonight from this passage deals with what I call a lack of consistency. Look at it again in verses 9 and 10, because we need to let the Scripture speak to us and let the Word of God speak for itself. James continues to talk about the tongue, and he says, in reference to the tongue, "Therewith bless we God, even the Father, and therewith curse we men, which are made after the similitude of God. Out of the same mouth proceedeth blessing and cursing. My brethren, these things ought not so to be." You know, James doesn't mince any words as he's talking about the tongue. And I look at that last phrase in verse number 10, "My brethren, these things ought not so to be." How often we feel like saying that to our children, or how often we feel like saying that to our employees, or whatever the case may be, here James is telling us that God is saying this to us through him. After a long Sunday morning service, a family sat down to eat lunch. The father bowed his head and said the blessing over the food. In doing such, he thanked the Lord for the meal, for the day that God had given them, thanked God for his family and for his home. Shortly after having said amen, however, he proceeded to fuss about the preacher, to complain about the church, to gripe about the music, to berate his boss, and so on. Nothing but complaints poured from his lips. It was then that his daughter asked, "Daddy, did God hear you when you said the blessing?" "Why, yes, sweetheart," he said, "God did." "Did God hear you when you were fussing after you prayed?" she asked. "Yes, I suppose he did." "Then which one did he believe?" the daughter asked. Out of the mouths of babes, the truth comes. James wants us to understand that we have a grave problem with our inconsistency in the way that we speak to God and then to each other. With the same mouth, James says, and I'm not adding anything, any words at all to this, with the same mouth we bless God and we curse men, he says. When we do this, you'll notice, I'm not pointing at anyone when I say this tonight, and I'm using we and not you. I remember this a long time ago. Somebody said that if you point, you know, remember that there are three fingers pointing back at you. That's why I always do this number. No, please understand when I say this tonight. When we do this, we displease the heart of God, and we show not only a lack of consistency, but also our lack of compassion and our lack of Christ-likeness. If there is one thing that should be said about a mature Christian, it is, at the very least, the desire to attempt to be consistent in our actions and reactions. Whether we are consistent or not, I'm not even dealing with that part of it right now. There should at least be a desire in us that we want to be consistent in our actions and reactions. It's kind of like this, too. Even in regards to church, and I want to say this in the right spirit tonight, I do think that we need to be a little bit more demonstrative and have a little bit more excitement about us when the Spirit of God moves upon us. There's nothing wrong with saying amen. There's nothing wrong with putting a hand in the air. There's nothing wrong with saying hallelujah and praise the Lord. But truthfully, it matters not how loud you shout or how high you jump. What matters most is how straight you walk when your feet hit the ground. Some consistency in things. We should have a desire to be consistent. And while we will not always get it right, we should strive to be consistent with our words. Again, it comes back to the issue of the heart. If our hearts are right, our words will be right. If our hearts are right, it could very well be said that we might not say anything at all. I'm learning that I am rarely sorry for words that I didn't say. If the tongue is inconsistent, hear me carefully on this tonight. If the tongue is inconsistent, there is a problem with the heart. The heart of the problem is truly the problem with the heart. The tongue that blesses the Father and yet curses those who have been made in the Father's image is in desperate need of spiritual medicine. James is warning us about this. He's giving us strict instruction and caution. How easy it is to sing the hymns during the worship service and then argue with the family in the car all the way home. It's easy to have that happen. That's why we walk back and forth. It's amazing. And I don't say this lightly tonight. If you've been in church any period of time, if you've tried to serve the Lord the best that you know how, I can almost promise you that one of the times when you and your family are going to get in an argument is either to or from church. It's sad when it happens that way, but it does. It does happen. It's amazing. You can be at one another's throats verbally, and you pull up into the church parking lot, and you open the door and get out, and everything's fine. Well, you know, it's interesting how that we do have a lack of consistency often. Secondly, tonight, James moves on to discuss not only a lack of consistency, but also a longing for comfort. In verses 11 and 12, James talks about fountains and fig trees. He talks about sweet and bitter waters and the type of fruit that would be produced by not only trees and vines, but by comparison, the types of fruits that will be produced by our lives. Look at the words with me again tonight. James 3, verses 11 and 12, the Bible says, "Doth a fountain send forth at the same place sweet water and bitter? Can the fig tree, my brethren, bear olive berries, either a vine figs? So can no fountain yield salt water and fresh." The fountain provides the water that man needs to survive. Have you ever thought about the fact that the human body, which is a resilient piece of craftsmanship from the Lord, that it can exist so many days without food, but yet it certainly is in need of water? Man needs water not only for drinking, but also for washing, for cooking, for farming, for a host of other activities. Water's necessary. Therefore, it should not surprise us that God's Word speaks about the parallels between water and words, and it speaks often about it. James is giving it to us here in chapter 3, but look at Proverbs 18, verse 4. "The words of a man's mouth are as deep waters, and the wellspring of wisdom as a flowing brook." James is echoing what Solomon has told us in Proverbs. Proverbs 13, verse 14, the first half of that verse, the Bible says, "The law of the wise is a fountain of life." The law, even the words of the wise, are a fountain of life. So let's understand it from this position tonight. Water is life-giving. However, if water is not controlled, it can cause death and destruction. Strange, isn't it, how that streams and rivers can bring both life and death. In certain parts of the country, we diligently watch as the floodwaters rise and even as property is swept away simply because of too much water. In the same way, our words can both help and hurt. "Let the levees of our lips break, and a flood of words pour from our tongues, and people's lives can be ruined by our lack of control." But James doesn't just compare our words to waters. He also compares the tongue to a tree. Just like a tree, our words can help shelter and encourage a weary traveler and feed a hungry soul. Yet the most important thing about a tree is its root system. Think with me about this for a moment tonight. And for those of you who have had items such as this in your yards, we had them in North Carolina. Brother Terry, we had 18 pine trees in our backyard in North Carolina. North American pines. Somebody help me with this sort of thing. Tell me what normally occurs, Brother David, when there's a storm and there's even a great saturation of the ground around pine trees, and then let there be some strong winds occur in that area. What happens often? The pine trees are not only blown from one side to the other, but they are quickly blown down. They're uprooted. Why? Because their root system doesn't go very deep. The tree itself may grow tall, but the root system is pretty shallow. It's interesting when I think about this. Most important thing about a tree is the root system. If the roots do not go down deep, the tree will not grow in a healthy manner and produce the right kind of fruit. So let me draw a parallel quickly tonight. If we are rooted in the things of the Lord as we should be, then our words will be the fruit of having been in fellowship with Him. If we're going to have tongues that delight the Lord and others, then we must meet with Him each day and learn from Him. In fact, Martin Luther, the great reformer, the one who began the Protestant Reformation, as the case would be, said that he never looked into the eyes of man until he first looked into the eyes of God. It's a pretty good rule of thumb. It's important for us to spend time in God's Word so that our spiritual roots go deep into it. But James speaks both plainly and practically here in James 3. He says, a fountain does not give forth both sweet and bitter water. We expect a fountain to flow with the same kind of water consistently. In fact, not trying to pick on Brother Tim as he's here tonight, our resident plumber in our midst, but I would venture to say that if we go to a fountain attempting to get some water from it, if that fountain has given forth good water all the time, consistently, there's never been a problem, but we go back again and something doesn't taste right, obviously there's something wrong somewhere. James is telling us that that's the case with our words even. You go to a literal fountain of water and you expect it to give fresh water all the time. You don't go back to it expecting to get salt water from it. You know, it's interesting as James talks about the fountains, he also tells us about the trees. We don't go to a fig tree to find olives. We don't look to pick grapes at an apple orchard. It's kind of like this, church. Nature produces after its own kind. So what is being said about our nature when we spew and sprout forth both blessings and cursing? What's being said about our nature? As we get ready to close tonight, and I've been a little more brief than normal this evening, let me share with you something that I came across recently that I believe will help all of us. It's called 12 Words That Can Transform Your Life. And I want you to look at this and listen and think for a few minutes. Because the way that we speak is important. The way that we talk to one another is important. So I want to give you 12 words that can transform your life. And here they are. The first three are simply this: please and thank you. When you use these three words, you are treating others with respect, and with compassion. You're treating them with appreciation when you say please and thank you. I would not even begin to ask the parents that are in here tonight to tell me how many times they put this into the lives of their children. What do we say, please? What do we say, thank you? You know, it's not like the one family that I heard of that when there was that sort of thing going on at the dinner table, what do we say? And the answer was, now! No, we say please, and we say thank you. Those three words are important words. They can change and transform our lives. Here are two more to add to this list. Two words, I'm sorry. These two words have a way of doing two things. They have a way of breaking down walls, and they have a way of building bridges. Totally unrelated to really anything tonight. Whether you are a parent or a grandparent, whether you have children or don't, there's nothing wrong. In fact, there's something very, very right when we have messed up to look at someone and say, I'm sorry. I started to add to this same little list of things, of 12 words that can transform your life. I started to put, in addition to I'm sorry, even the two-word phrase, forgive me. I think they go pretty well right there together. Let's look at three more in this list of 12 words that can transform your life. It's the phrase, I love you. While some are accustomed to hearing these in connection with romance, it really goes much, much deeper than that. Most certainly should go much deeper than that for the Christian. I love you is a statement that can carry tremendous power. In fact, we may never know it, but we may be the only person that says those three words to someone. And I want you to let that sink in. We may be the only person that says to another individual, I love you. And that it's conveyed in the right Christian manner, but that they hear that someone cares about them. We may be the only person that says that to somebody. Last four words in this list of 12 words that can transform your life. Oh, how important they are for us as Christians. I'm praying for you. I can tell you as a pastor, these four words mean more to me than you will ever know. I think it is important to understand that when we talk to God about people, we are given opportunities to talk to people about God. I'm convinced of that fact. So let's make sure, too, that, by the way, when we look at somebody and we say, Brother Mike, I'm praying for you, let's make sure we are doing it. Let's make sure that when someone comes up to us and says, Brother Freddie, would you pray with me about a situation? One of the things that I have been trying to do in my own life, and I don't succeed at it like I need to, but if someone says to me after a service, Pastor, would you pray with me or pray for me about this situation? Brother Terry, I try right there. I try to stop right then. And it may be a 15 or 20 second prayer, but I try to pray for that person right then and there. I don't want to be as Samuel said, but God forbid that I should sin in not praying for you. The smallest but biggest troublemaker in the world is the tongue. But it doesn't have to be. God can use our tongues to direct people to Him, to everlasting life in heaven, and to an abundant life here on earth. Oh, how wonderful it would be if we were to give God our tongue and our heart every day, and then watch as He allows us to be a blessing to others. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, my Lord and my Redeemer. Good night. God bless you. You're dismissed.